Here they come. Once again, if you look down the channel, you'll shortly see two teams of Special Operations snipers from Jordan, Canada, and the United States aboard two MH-6 Little Bird helicopters. The helicopters will establish a sniper position overlooking the Ebony Village. These expert marksmen carry high-powered rifles capable of hitting targets more than a mile away. As you see the birds, you will notice that these individuals are sitting on external seats or benches as the aircraft approaches the drop-off point. The MH-6 Little Bird helicopter is an extremely maneuverable aircraft capable of infiltrating personnel into very tight spaces such as rooftops, small jungle openings, and tight intercity roadways.
Each gun can carry up to 6,000 rounds per minute.
the force will discover a weapons and ammunition cache. Much like a real mission, because of limited time and no means to remove the items, the team will place C4 explosives on the cache, using time-delayed fuse. The explosive charge is calculated to detonate after the element leaves the barge.
Next to the Adventure Center grounds. The SEALs who have remained underwater
30 aircraft. These boats perform short-range insertion and extraction, coastal resupply, and coastal surveillance missions. These rugged, versatile craft have a range of 200 nautical miles when traveling at 32 knots with a top speed of 45 knots. gentlemen, this is not an easy task. Just imagine doing this at night in freezing cold water, in a pitching sea, weighed down by lots of gear, with the helicopter rotor quad constantly beating down on you.
Keep the jumpers in the air for up to 4 to 6 minutes. shit I've ever heard. What about you guys?
Did you get sick?
Oh.
Considered to be one of the military's most demanding and potentially hazardous advanced skills, military free-fall parachute operations are used to infiltrate enemy areas under cover of darkness to avoid detection.
One of them seem like it's out of control.
Special operations military free-fall personnel are taught to conduct high-altitude, low-opening missions by exiting an aircraft at altitudes up to 30,000 feet. Typically, the parachute is free-fall to about 4,000 feet, often reaching speeds up to 120 miles per hour before deploying their chutes.
Night.
A similar activity known as high-altitude, high-opening parachute missions, in which parachutists exit at high altitudes and deploy their canopies using highly maneuverable gliding parachute systems to silently travel distances of more than 50 kilometers while under canopy. These highly trained individuals conduct military free-fall operations in the dead of night while fully loaded with up to 100 pounds of combat equipment and wearing a special helmet, goggles, and oxygen mask. The parachute used in today's exercise is the Advanced Ram Air Parachute, or ARAM. The ARAM parachute canopy is actually an airfoil designed similar to an aircraft's wing. It has a curved upper surface and a flat lower surface with wind cells that provide the lift required to support the weight of the parachutist, his equipment, and then deliver them safely to the ground. These highly trained operators make this look easy. In actuality, a crew of dedicated professionals must work in concert to make this drop a success. First, the pilot of the aircraft must deliver the jumpers over their target area. Then the jumpmaster of the aircraft must pinpoint the drop zone, often at night, from an altitude where only high-level topography is visible. Then the jumpers must exit the aircraft at a precise moment, calculated to accommodate the speed of the aircraft, the time they spend during freefall, the time they will spend under canopy, and the distance they must travel to the target. While under this canopy, the jumpers are constantly interpreting the wind direction, the wind speed, and they're making the final steering corrections required to remain not only gripped in the air, but it also allows them to land together on the target. This wind direction and the wind speed will normally change and fluctuate at various altitudes, often 3 to 4 times during their descent. This forces the jumpers to actually pilot and maneuver their canopies like you're seeing here today. Combat controllers, who you can see positioned on top of the Tampa General Hospital. This team is not only responsible for controlling the layering of all of today's military aircraft, but they're also responsible for coordinating airspace with the Federal Aviation Administration, Tampa International Airport, Peter O. Knight Municipal Airport, MacDill Air Force Base, and all the other aircraft that enter into this area. The combat controllers are certified air traffic controllers, and they perform all their duties out of a small rucksack. This event brings together today U.S. and international special operations leaders from around the world to strengthen existing and build new enduring relationships among all our international soft partners. Over 80 nations this week were with us in Tampa. They were exchanging ideas, learning from one another, and building trust. It is this trust that will provide invaluable when we all come together to achieve mutual objectives against our future adversaries. Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention up the cut. Shortly you will see a returning rigid hull inflatable boat, where you'll see the hostage played by Tampa Mayor Bob Buckhorn return to the convention center grounds. Another thing that you'll see while we're waiting on the boat is it's impressive that all of this was put together, all the tactics, the techniques, the procedures. We had to merge with personnel from 17 different nations. We had to